Good afternoon again.
Good afternoon.
When I thought about this subject of immigration, I knew it's going to be a very sensitive one. Because when you talk about immigration, especially in this country, when you talk about it, there are all kinds of views from people. It's a controversial issue. And yet we have seen in the news, I was even reading, Janet sent a document, a file. This is relating to the situation that's going on with the immigrants coming from Congo, about, you know, the difficulty that they have and all the statistics. But immigration is not just statistics. When you say immigrants, they have faces. You know, I'd like to show different, you know, faces of people. Immigrants are people. They come from different countries. Even sometimes when you say white immigrants, really, in reality, there are, even then, there's the Armenian, Russian, German, even the Hispanics sometimes are considered whites. They're different people. Asians are also different. But their faces, they're like you and I, you know, the immigrants. And because they're so, because this topic is, I think, is a very sensitive one, I feel that as a church we should learn to look at the issue not from the political viewpoint. Because it is natural when we say, what do you say about illegal immigration or immigration as a whole? Quickly, we form our opinion. But the question is, what informs our opinion? And each of us have political leanings. Democrats have their own opinion towards immigration. Republicans have their own opinion towards that subject too. Libertarians, I mean, everybody have their own political viewpoint. And so when this issue is talked about, like in this church, you know, quickly those things jump in. It's a knee-jerk reaction. We think politically. But for the church to engage in this issue that's really growing, we need to be able to get out of that knee-jerk reaction politically and ask the question, what about our Lord Jesus Christ? So I invite you, can we do that? Can we, at this time, can we remove all our political leanings? I'm not a Democrat. I'm not a Republican either, you know. I'm in between. I don't even know what party I am in, but I really don't care. But the point I have is that for us, I think today, it will be good for us to look at Jesus Christ as the one that will inform us as the church. Jesus is the one that will inform us and to guide us regarding this subject of immigration. Before we can get engaged, the topic is getting the church engaged, the church responding. Before we can do something to the people that we are talking about, before we can do that, we need to examine the scriptures. And so we have a lot of scriptures today on what God says about this topic, about legal or illegal or whatever it is. We should be united in our belief as a church. You agree? And we should also be united in our response, in how we behave as a church. Because when we're one, there's more strength in being one. So if you and I understand and we commit to this, if we commit to our Lord Jesus, His biblical and His missional, you know, His love going out, His missional, if we focus on that, then we will indeed be more equipped. We will be more ready to get engaged and respond to the needs of the immigrants, the strangers, the homeless. Because that's the issue right now. I mean, it's growing and we can't stop that. How many of you know immigrants? Look, the person standing in front of you. So that is my request, to remove from our minds, if we can, anything political, anything that will influence us or affect us from desiring to see God's point of view. Because if we already engage in the political viewpoint, then it's going to blind us to see what the Bible is saying. You know, I know I say it so many times, but it's critical, it's important. Let's clear our minds and focus on Jesus Christ. Our goal is to be united in belief and united in response. God's people, we should all be able to agree that immigrants, regardless of status, are all people made in the image of God. Right? Everybody. Made in the image of God, for whom He sent Jesus Christ, His Son, to die for. Did Jesus die for immigrants? Of course He did. And our response to immigrants should be in the same way as God's response and perspective should be the same, because we are God's people. We are the people of God. So the political, economic, and cultural issues should only be secondary. Primary should be that of the biblical perspective from Jesus Christ. So that's how we start. So while the biblical teaching, you know, from the Bible, while the biblical teaching is important and should be our first step, we also need to understand that what very crucial to dealing with immigrants, strangers, the homeless, and so forth, is the aspect of relationship. You know, we understand that. So let me explain. It is going to be very hard. It's going to be difficult to love the people, the immigrants, the strangers, the homeless. It's going to be difficult to love the people God has brought into our communities if we don't get to know them, if we don't have a developed relationship with them. Otherwise, they will be statistics. And when you don't know people, if you only see them as numbers, your feeling for them is different. So we understand that. Okay, the Bible's important, the Word of God's important, but we also understand, you know, that we have to develop a relationship and begin to form ways and means, and we will go through that next time, practical ways and means for the church on how we can begin to develop relationship with these people of God. They are people of God too. To look for opportunities to build mutual relationship. When Jesus came to the Jews many years ago, He brought to them a message that the Gentiles, to the surprise of the Jews, Jesus Christ brought a message that the Gentiles are very much a part of God's community. They struggled with it. I mean, Peter and the apostles, you know, the Jews, because they had a different perspective of Gentiles, right? The Jews. So Jesus Christ brought a different message. Jesus Christ looked at the Gentiles and then began to teach the apostles, you know, the church, that the Gentiles should be a part of them. Because the Jews look at the Gentiles with a certain prejudice. Even the Samaritans, who are kind of half-half, you know, they don't look at them with favor. The Jews have always looked at Gentiles with discrimination. And the Gentiles did the same to the Jews. You know, it's the same thing. The Romans looked down on the Jews. The Samaritans, I mean, the Syrians, the Babylonians, you know, all of this, they all, you know, they think that discrimination and prejudice is only during our time now. No, it has been there. It's part of human history, human civilization. But Christ wanted to change all of that. He wants to change all of that. He wanted to show that His is a growing family. That His is not an exclusive family, but includes all of humanity. That's Christ's perspective. All belonging to Jesus. When my child were growing up, I have four children. Of course, you know that. Four children. And we love our children equally. All the four. I love all my four kids. But sometimes we get misunderstood by our kids. It happens. Let me explain. As a parent of four children, when one of my kids, one of them, gets sick or is in pain or is in crisis, when one kid is in pain or sick, it is not at all difficult for my wife and myself to focus and give more time to the needy. We focus, give more energy, you know, give them a lot of favor because they're sick. I mean, that's normal. We give them kind of an extra grace and love because they're sick, because we're concerned for the sick child. But everybody knows, and I know, that I'm not excluding the other children. Of course I love all, but there are moments in time when, as a father, I look at my child that is needy, and I give that child special attention. And as I meditate on how I understand, or how I came to understand Jesus Christ, it seems that Jesus, when we study the Bible, when we study the scriptures, it seems that Jesus has consistently given priorities to those who are in pain, to those who are in crisis, to those who are in trouble, to those who seem to be hopeless. Christ seemed to have, and we are going through these scriptures on seeking the heart of Jesus when it comes to the strangers. So my impression of the story of God when I read the Bible is that those who are in the margin, those who are in the fringes, or those who are on the sideline, are very much at the center of His love and concern. That does not mean that Jesus loved others less. As I mentioned, you know, using my personal example, but those people really need extra care from God. And as I meditate on what I understand, it seems Jesus really, in the scriptures, show a heart that is tender and gracious. That's who God is. Oftentimes, you know, people have this strong reaction of God is not fair. You know, I mean, why there's more attention to this? And, you know, well, God is fair. When He died on the cross, His death on the cross is for all humanity. That one act is equal. It's equal. But the Bible does tell us so many examples of God's heart that is tender towards those who are needy, hungry, hopeless, homeless, and so forth. You know, John 3:16 tells us that God cares for all humanity. No exception, no favoritism. For God so loved the converted world, no. For God so loved the white people, no. For God so loved the Filipino, no. I mean, everybody, right? I mean, I think that's very basic. We know that. So let's look at the beginning here for a big picture. Look at Jesus' example. It is interesting, as I study this, that Jesus chose, God chose, that Jesus enters the world as a Galilean Jew from Galilee. I think that is a deliberate decision, a deliberate act of God, and it is significant. God chose not to bring up Jesus or incarnate Jesus among the religious leaders. He was not like the son of Caiaphas' wife, you know, or Herod, or Pontius Pilate, or Caesar. No, God deliberately chose that He is going to be a Jew, not just a Jew, but a Galilean Jew. That's God's choice. He comes and he was born in the fringes of that society, margin of that society, where the Romans looked down. In history, we see Romans, even historians, Josephus, even mentioned that oftentimes those people in the Galilean area have been looked down. Even the Jews looked down on Galilee. I check on the commentaries and they give some reasons. One is they look down on the Galilean area because, one, the Galileans racially are not at all very pure. Because if you see the map of Israel at that time, Galilee is in the northernmost part out there. And then there is Samaria in between. You know, there is Jerusalem, there is Samaria, then there is Galilee here on top. And they are the most Hellenized. Hellenized, meaning the Greek influence was stronger among the Galileans. So when it comes to that, they look at them as not pure. You know, the Galileans are not pure, so they were looked down. And geographically, they're kind of far away, so they don't kind of give them much respect. Linguistically also, the Galileans spoke not really a good, pure Jewish language, but it has an Aramaic version. And they have a certain twang, certain accent that people laugh at in the way the commentaries, I don't know what it is, but they say their accent is kind of weird, you know, like a pidgin type of English, you know, today. It's not something that they admire, even linguistically. And religiously, they are more mixed because of the Hellenization, the influence of the Greek civilization, so they are more liberal from that aspect. So they were looked down. So instead, he comes into the world of the Galileans. That's why in John 1, if we go to John 1, verse 46, The reason I'm giving this story is I want to point to you all that Jesus Christ understood how it is to be in the margin. In John 1, verse 46. Let's go to John 1, verse 46. It says here, Nazareth? Can anything good come from there? Nathaniel asked. That is, you know, it's almost like saying, the Philippines? Can anything good come from the Philippines? I don't feel good, right? If you hear that, I mean, all of us come from different places. If somebody says that, that's kind of it's a put down. So that's the background here. Galileans were generally looked down by Judeans, much like, because there's a lot of farms in that area, it's like rural farming communities in the American South, kind of looked down by the more industrial northerners. And the Aramaic dialect of Galileans was very noticeable, and they are looked down. So that's the situation here. And to make the life of Jesus have been even more challenging and difficult, Joseph and Mary, when Jesus was born, remember that story? And Herod was out to kill the babies? Joseph and Mary were forced to flee for their lives, to save their family and their son to a neighboring nation, Egypt, as immigrant. So even at the time Christ was born, they had to flee from one nation to another nation because of persecution, because they were killing the babies. So Jesus experienced that. And like most immigrants, they experience what it is to have no permanent housing. Even when Mary was pregnant, remember in Bethlehem, they were struggling with finding a place. But it was a time of crisis, and so Jesus understood how it is to be a stranger in another country, to be homeless, to be an immigrant. In fact, when the Bible says stranger, it means foreigner, or in modern language, immigrant. We don't call people strangers today, right? We don't. Are you a resident stranger? We don't. But that is what it is. So if you are familiar with the stories of Jesus, ministry, the gospel, we see Jesus was constantly concerned with those that are pushed aside by the general population. We have these people from Congo coming. And that's going to be very difficult for them, because people in Congo who move as refugees in Malawi, that is such a big, big contrast to U.S. civilization. And when I read that story, you know, I read more from Wikipedia, that story, my heart kind of melted about this. There's so much persecution, there is so much killing in Congo, and people have to escape, go to Malawi, that area, and wait for years. And you can't really blame them. I will do the same. If there is such thing happening in my country, I will flee. I will get out, you know, and flee. We saw the movie last week. And we see where these people from Sudan were running away, and they say, let's go to Ethiopia. And they walk for days and how many weeks or months, these little kids. And when they're about to go to the border of Ethiopia, they have to go back because they heard, oh, you cannot go there because the armies are in the border and they're also killing the refugees. Instead, go to Kenya. Go up there again. So I understand, and I'm sure Jesus experienced, his family experienced the same thing, running away from persecution, from death. That's what happened. So we are very familiar with that. And this happened with people who live in Haiti, people in Vietnam. This is part of our history. Libya, I mean, thousands of people today from that country in Libya flee, and they ride the boat. Thank you, Brian. They ride the boat, and the news says probably a few thousands just have died because the boats capsize. And that's how bad immigration is. And if I am in their situation, I will do the same. I will save my family. This is what some of the Jews did when they heard of what Hitler planned to do. And they acted quickly. They ran away. They migrated to other places like USA. But those who stayed got massacred and killed. And it is still an ongoing thing. If I live in Iraq, if I live in Afghanistan, if I live in Syria, I will be one of those people pulling my kids. I will be. That's why I can't blame those people who do that. So we are familiar. So I find it very interesting that Jesus Christ, you know, was himself an immigrant. And then when he dealt with, whenever he dealt with the rich and the poor, I mean the rich people, I mean, when he dealt with them like Zacchaeus, remember Zacchaeus welcomed Jesus? It's interesting that Jesus somehow always point to the rich, the redemptive opportunity, and to make things right for the poor. That's what Jesus, whenever he talked to the rich, he says, you have a responsibility for the poor. And he reminds them to make right their relationship, because they probably became wealthy because of corruption and, you know, stealing and all of that. So that's Jesus. That's why in John 3:17, it says Jesus came not to condemn the world, but to save. That is the response. But to save, to have that heart, to have that mentality. Whenever we are confronted with people who are struggling, the heart is wanting to save. Jesus never asked, you know, are you documented, you know, before you help them? He doesn't ask that. I mean, that's not in there. So, and then when we look at the teachings in the Bible, Jesus also has parables. When he taught people, he put lessons in those parables, the right understanding, you know, the kingdom in relationship with those who are in the fringes of the society. For example, you know, a parable, Jesus said, hey, when you throw a party, when you throw a social event, Jesus said, let's go there instead. Let's go to Luke 14, verse 12. I think to make it clear, Matthew, Mark, Luke. Luke chapter 14, verse 12. Luke 14, verse 12. Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back and you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, invite the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." Jumping to verse 23, "Then the master told his servant, because there was this invitation and the people were not coming, the people who are supposed to be there and close and friends and relatives or whatever, they won't come to the banquet that was prepared. And so what does Jesus say?" Verse 23, "Then the master told his servant, go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in." Even people you don't know, strangers out there who are not invited. "So that my house will be full. And I tell you, not one of those who are invited will get a taste of my banquet." I mean, there are people who have the opportunity, but they won't come. That's why Jesus said, you know, those people are special for me too. Very special. The kingdom of God is like a party, Jesus says. Isn't that interesting that Jesus Christ describes the kingdom of God as one that invites strangers? The picture of the kingdom is not one that is just a family party. It is a picture of a lunch where strangers and foreigners and hungry and sick are invited. There is the picture of the kingdom of God. Isn't that amazing? That is the picture that Christ is seeing here. So, another example is the Good Samaritan. The Good Samaritan. In teaching his disciples what kind of love Jesus Christ has, he tells the story of a man beaten, broken on the side, by the side of the road. Neglected by whom? Neglected by the religious people, folks, but shown love and kindness and mercy by whom? The stranger, the Good Samaritan, the one that the Jews despise. The hero in the story is the stranger, the foreigner is the hero, where he has mercy. You know this, and he demonstrated what it means to love our neighbor. Now, for Jesus, in this story, walking by and ignoring the needs of the needy is not an option in his kingdom. It is not an option for people who claim to have a relationship with the Father. That is not an option. It's got to be nature. But the fact is, the Good Samaritan here is Jesus. The Good Samaritan pictures who Jesus, because it is the Good Samaritan who lavishly, right? What the Samaritan did was above normal. It is ridiculously overflowing grace. So the Good Samaritan pictures Jesus. That I find interesting, that our Lord Jesus would choose for himself a picture of one who is a foreigner. And so it shows the heart of Jesus that he's not in any way discriminating or prejudice, but he used that example. What the Samaritan did was an act of God, in what God would do. That's what he did. So it's a deliberate story, a non-Jew that is looked down, but it's an amazing story because Jesus is saying, I am a stranger, I am a foreigner, I'm not of your civilization, Jews, I'm not, but I love you, I am willing to do this for you. And he identifies with the foreigners. Of course, he was a Jew, but in this story, is identifying with a foreigner. Matthew 25, verses 25. Let's go to Matthew 25, verse 25. So are you beginning to see so many examples? I mean, if we look at Jesus himself, about the heart of Jesus towards the immigrants, Matthew 25, 25. 25, let's see. Or is it 26? You know the story here where he tells people in Matthew 25 about what you should do for the rest, where he said, verse 31. When the Son of Man comes in His glory and all the angels with Him, He will sit on His glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on His right hand and the goats on the left. Then the King will say to those on the right, "Come, you who are blessed," and so forth. So let's go to verse 35. For I was hungry. I think this is what I wanted, verse 35. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. Wow. Jesus identifies with the immigrant, the stranger. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. You know what is that saying? What Jesus is saying is, when you do this to the stranger, you did it to me. Whoa. Now, that's why I said remove all the political viewpoints here. Because in politics, you know, we quickly embrace the legalistic aspect of the law and miss the whole point of Christ. Jesus said, I was a stranger and you invited me. Another example, I need clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in a prison and you came to visit me. None here, it says, for I was a documented stranger and you invited me in. You know, I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. And I was an innocent prisoner. You know, I was not a guilty, I mean, look at that. When you go visit somebody in prison, it doesn't matter whether they're guilty or innocent. You know, God wants us to visit even though they are guilty murderers, right? We show the love. I was in prison and you came to visit. There is no discrimination whether a person is guilty or what. There's none. And we saw that in the previous series, in the same thing with different lifestyle and communities. You know, we love. We love people. So I think that's very, very clear. We minister to Jesus, when we minister to the stranger and the immigrant. So the Bible reminds us that Jesus is that way. And in fact, when Jesus was crucified, remember what he chose, deliberate choice, where Jesus was crucified? He was crucified at Golgotha. You know that place? That has a history. Golgotha, that place, is where they kill the criminals, the guilty, the murderers, the thieves, and all those criminals. Imagine Jesus Christ chose a place where criminals and the guilty are being killed to be like one of them, to take our sin, because in a way he said, I have taken your sin. He died like a murderer, like a thief, because that's where he is. That's how much, even in death, Jesus Christ chose to identify with people who are in the fringes. That's our Lord, our God. And he chose to lay down his reputation, not only his life, to die where the criminals are. It's not only to lose your life, but to lose your reputation. It's very shameful to die with, you know, what will people say? Sometimes when we serve the homeless, this is a struggle for the church. It was a struggle for Peter. Remember the story? Paul rebuked Peter because Peter was having a good meal and conversation with the Gentiles. And then some of the Judaizers, some of the Jews came in, and Peter saw the Jews, and his reputation was at stake. He didn't want to lose his reputation. So what happened? He stood up and left. To be a disciple of Jesus is willing to lose our lives and lose our reputation. That's to be a disciple, to be a follower of Jesus. So there's a huge contrast there. So it is possible for the people of God who truly love God and yet fall into the tentacles of prejudice and discrimination. And that act is so contagious, especially Christians who are respected doing it. So when Peter, the story, you can go there on your own, but it's Galatians 2, 11 to 14. For lack of time, let me just move on. But Galatians 2, 11 to 14, when Peter was so afraid to lose his reputation, to be found out with Gentiles, as soon as they stood up and left, you know what happened? The others with Peter saw Peter, because they respect him, they also stood up and followed him. And Paul said, "What a shame that you do that." So that's what happened. So that's an example for us that we have to be willing to even lose our reputation. What we care about is not what the world says or what other Christians will say. What we care about is what God thinks. You have great honor, in the eyes of God if you lose your reputation for the sake of Christ. So God allows His only begotten Son to be murdered and crucified alongside the criminals, so that everyone in the human race would understand that no one is beyond redemption. Everyone is within the redemption of Christ. I believe that there are groups in our society who are looked down and rejected. I also understand that sometimes we call them names. I don't know what, it's like with the gay community, we have names. So one of the things that we should begin to learn is not use words and names to call them whoever they are. The issue is growing in our country, this situation. Yes, there are laws. There are immigration laws, and many of these immigrants have broken them. That's why it's called undocumented or illegal immigrants. But where is the heart of Jesus in this? Where is His heart? Will Jesus care for strangers? Yes. Does He care for the poor and the homeless? Yes. Will Jesus report the strangers to the Romans? No, because He was once Himself an immigrant. And as a former immigrant myself, and I'm an immigrant, a citizen now, I believe in the upholding of the law. I believe that the laws governing immigration should be followed, and I believe that it is the responsibility of the state to enforce those laws, but I also believe in what the Bible says, and I can see the heart of Jesus. And He wants me to focus on what Jesus will do. That's not my responsibility as far, because the governments, almost every other year, they keep changing laws anyway. They keep changing rules. In fact, the government's the first one to break the laws. That happens too. But it saddens me, as an immigrant myself, when I hear other fellow immigrants who became citizens here and also hear prejudice from them against others who are not yet. We should not, because all of us have been immigrants. I also am sad when just because a person may not, may be a stranger, And then people take advantage of them in this society. They take advantage of them and abuse them. But anyway, if you go through the scriptures, there's a lot where God is against that. So the suffering of Jesus, you know, his brutal death, even we all see that as an act of grace, because that is something, an act of God that shows how much he cares for everybody. So when we speak about God's love for the stranger, when we speak of God's love for the immigrant, it is deeply rooted in God's redemptive nature. God's nature, God's character. And that is the good news. Loving strangers is part of the good news because it shows the extent of God's love. It's not being picky or choosy, but it's loving the poor, loving the strangers, the homeless, the sick, the unemployed, all of that, you know, included. Many immigrants, why do people come? Now, I am speaking not only before the American audience, but to the rest. You know, because I come from another country, sometimes I have a different perspective from perhaps one that is here in this country. I tend to look at things from a more global kind of perspective. Immigrants become immigrants because they seek for better opportunities. Is that wrong? When we see in the story, they look for ways for a chance to provide life, an extension of life for their families, or even a better life. I mean, what would you do? Imagine if you close your eyes, what if you are in their situation? What if you are there in Syria? What if you are there in a place where there is such persecution? What, you know, all of this. What will you do? I mean, won't you show your love for your family? As I said, I will. So they take all that chance, and sometimes they can be so desperate, and many of them die. Even the Europeans, I mean, in the early history of the United States, how did the immigrants, white Europeans, come here? I mean, we have the potato famine, is that in Ireland? We have the persecution. I mean, come on! All nations, most nations or immigrants who came to the United States came because they want to have a better life. Whether it was British, Irish, German, everybody. Just because they came ahead of the others does not mean that they are more righteous. You know, there are others now who are coming who are in a worse condition too. So who am I to judge them? Again, there are laws, and I don't break laws, but God wants us to focus on the plight, the situation of those people. Many of those who come today have come from persecution, where it is really tough to be from their places. So I think we should understand that. We should understand. Exodus 23, verse 9. Just another scripture here. God warned the Israelites not to oppress the stranger. We can go to Exodus 23, verse 9, Mark. God warned the Israelites not to oppress the strangers. He entreated them to remember the time when they were themselves strangers. He reminded them that they, of all the people, you Israel, you Jews, of all the people, you should remember what it feels to be a stranger, because for hundreds of years, you were strangers in Egypt. You know, they know. That's why God said, hey, and don't oppress them, because you yourself were once. So, you know, the same way. This is not a Republican or Democrat issue. This is what God is saying. It is that important. 84% in a survey done, 84% of evangelicals said that their churches never talk about immigration ever, you know, because of the sensitivity. That is not because there is a lack of scripture. No, in fact, there is a lot of scripture. Here is one thing I found interesting. In the Old Testament, the command of God that is most common is worship God. You know what is the second one? After worship God? Welcome strangers. Whoa, welcome. You know, that there's so much in the scripture where it says, welcome strangers, you know, foreigner, alien. And in fact, the word is G-E-R, ger. When they say stranger, it is actually, you know, foreigner, one who comes from another country. That's what it is. In fact, the word in the Bible, the word that says be hospitable, hospitality. You know what hospitality in Greek is? It's philoxenia. It's the opposite of xenophobia. You know, the fear of foreigners is xenophobia. Xeno, X-E-N-O, is alien. And then phobia is fear. But the opposite of xenophobia is philoxenia. You know what that is? The love of strangers. The love of foreigners. Sometimes you think, you know, pastor is, I hear people say, pastor is so hospitable. You know, in reality, I'm not. Because I invite people that I know and love, family and friends. The real hospitality from the scripture is love of strangers. Man, my hospitality is so, compared to what it should be, I'm so far, far behind the standards that is set. You know, that's what it is. So here we see, I don't think I can go through a lot of the scriptures. Zechariah 7:10, if you want to check this, it says the same way, do not oppress the widow, the fatherless, the foreigner, or the poor. There are always these quartet words that is being used here, and this, the widow, the fatherless, the foreigner, and the poor. In Old Testament, that summary term is always together, that God chose is the widow, the fatherless, the foreigner, the poor. You see that foreword in the Bible so many times. It's interesting that God cares for them. You know, Malachi 3:5, it says, do not defraud laborers of their wages who oppress the widow and the fatherless and deprive the foreigners among you of justice. God wants nations, not just this country. God wants nations to treat the foreigners with dignity and respect and with justice. Now it's not the same. If you are a foreigner, you go to another country, you get killed, you get to be a slave. I mean, all the things that nations do to immigrants and foreigners is just the opposite of what God is saying. And these people, like these kids that we saw in the movie last week, they're trying to save their life and they get killed by the militia. You know, talk about total opposite of what God is teaching. Psalms also mentioned that in Psalms 146 verse 9. The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow. Whoa, the Lord cares for the foreigners. Deuteronomy 10 verse 17 to 18. The Lord your God defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow and loves the foreigner residing among you. Whoa. Did you know that God designed a system where he said to the farmers of Israel, when you plant a field and you harvest, don't harvest that is what is on the corner, on the fringes, because that is reserved for the strangers and the poor. Isn't God amazing? That God is thinking about those people that he cares for them and so that they don't. And wow. I mean, let's talk about God's people. Who of them have experienced being a foreigner? Was Abraham an immigrant? Get thee out of your country, right? Jacob, Isaac. I mean, Isaac went to another country to find a wife. That still happens. I mean, look at that. I mean, you can see a lot of the examples in the Bible, you know, people of God who are, you know, strangers, and they travel, and they're immigrants. So I think here we see that God's heart, you know, shows that he is a good God, that he cares for the immigrants, the strangers, the homeless, and the poor. Next week, I will try to make this more practical. I'll do a flip chart here, and we will, it will be a discussion among ourselves and find ways for us, the church, on what we can do to have practical steps on making a difference in the lives of the strangers, immigrants, poor, and homeless. So that we will do that next time, to discover practical wisdom on how we can, as a congregation and as individuals, make a difference in their lives. Amen?
Amen.
Father, we thank you for the words that you've given to us through your scriptures. Thank you for revealing to us your heart for people, for the strangers, the poor, the widows, the fatherless. Thank you, Lord, and help us, Lord God, to begin to think about this so that next week, Lord, we can discuss and, Lord, truly, where the rubber meets the road, truly have an impact and help people who are in need. Thank you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.